guys think safe in our business? So last class, for our last online session, we learned the third lesson, magnetism, and we are going to see the magnetism and the magnetic effect of current against this line. From that, we see the introduction to magnetism. Magnetism is derived from iron core, magnetite, which means Fe2O3, isn't it? Then we see the properties of magnetism, isn't it? What are the things we see? Magnetic dipole moment, magnetic flux, magnetic field, then properties of magnetic force, then we see the types of bar magnet, then we see the types of types of magnetic field. So, first, what is the magnetic dipole moment? The magnetic dipole moment is defined as product of its dipole strength and magnetic length, isn't it? So, what is the magnetic dipole moment? The magnetic dipole moment, what is that? The magnetic dipole moment, PM, is defined as the product of its pole strength and magnetic length. Product of its pole strength and magnetic length. Product of its pole strength and magnetic length. Then we see the magnetic flux, isn't it? So, what is the magnetic flux? The number of magnetic field lines, what is that? The number of magnetic field lines passing through the given area, what is that? The number of magnetic field lines passing through the given area, that's called as a magnetic flux. Then we see the magnetic field. What is the magnetic field? The magnetic field is defined as the force experienced by, what is that? The force experienced by unit pole strength, that's called as a magnetic field. So what is magnetic field? The magnetic field is the force experienced by unit pole strength, is called as a magnetic field. Then we see the magnet, isn't it? So naturally we have two forms of magnet. One is a natural magnet and one is an artificial magnet. Natural magnets means cobalt, nickel, these are the examples of a natural magnets, and artificial magnet means what is the artificial magnets means the man-made magnet. Okay? The man-made magnets, it will be have a regular shape. If it is have a regular shape means, and they having a permanent magnetic property means, that's called as an artificial magnet. Example, when the magnet is in the form of rectangular shape or a cylindrical shape, we call it as a bar magnet, isn't it? Then we see the properties of magnetic fields. That is one of our important three mark question, properties of magnetic fields. So what is the properties of magnetic fields here? Four properties, isn't it? First one is that the magnetic fields are continuous closed curve, where outside the bar magnet it flows from north pole to south pole, and inside the bar magnet it flows from south pole to north pole. Then second one, the magnetic field lines. What is that? The magnetic field lines never intersect each other. What is that? The magnetic field line never intersect each other. And that point, the direction of magnetic field at any point gives the tangent line drawn gives the direction. The tangent to the line which gives the drawn which gives the direction of a magnetic field. And fourth point, the related closeness of a magnetic field which gives the magnetic strength. Isn't it? The closeness of a magnetic field which gives the magnetic strength. Where the magnetic field lines are close to each other, that point the magnetic field will be maximum. Where the magnetic field lines are apart each other, the other point magnetic field strength will be minimum. Okay, these are the parts we have learned in the last sessions. And then these are the types of magnetic field. What are types of magnetic field we have? We have two forms of magnetic field. One is an uniform magnetic field, another one is a non-uniform magnetic field. Uniform magnetic field means they having a same magnitude and the same direction, and it is non-uniform magnetic field means they having a different magnitude and different direction, or same direction and a different magnitude. Okay, clear? And today's sessions we are going to see the Coulomb's inverse formula and the magnetic field at a point along the axial line. Okay, today we are going to see the Coulomb's inverse formula and the magnetic field at a point along the axial line. So first, Coulomb's inverse formula. I hope already we learned the Coulomb's law in electrostatics. Then first lesson we learned Coulomb's law in electrostatics. What are the things we learned there? The force of attraction or repulsion between any two point charges, isn't it? The force of attraction or repulsion between any two point charges is defined as, what is that? The force of attraction or repulsion between any two point charges is defined as product of their charges and inversely proportional to square of a distance between them, isn't it? So what we get that? F is equal to K into Q1Q2 by R square, and the value of K is equal to 1 by 4 by epsilon 0. If this car doesn't constant and epsilon so is called as a permeability in free space. So if you substitute the value, what you get F is equal to 1 by 4 by epsilon 0 q1 q2 by r square along with r square. Okay, it will be learned in the first lesson. So what is first lesson we learn? The Coulomb's law in electrostatics. from the pull side another sort of point is that the force will be directly proportional to product of the charges and inversely proportional to square of the distance. That is clear. So here for that as a regarda Coulomb's inverse square line magnetism. Okay, what is that? The Coulomb's inverse square line magnetism. We take a two bar magnet. Okay, we take a two bar magnet. Each bar magnet having a north pole, south pole, north pole, south pole, north pole, and having a pole strength. Each of having a pole strength equal. Okay, because each pole having the same pole strength. It is a bar magnet magnetism. Each pole having a same pole strength should be equal. So when the north pole of a when the south pole of a bar magnet A is moved towards the south pole of a B bar magnet, otherwise the north pole of a bar magnet is moved towards the north pole of a B magnet. Means what suppose the experience? We know like force always repel each other, isn't it? So they experiencing a repulsive force. So the south pole of a bar magnet is moved towards the south pole of a B bar magnet. Otherwise, the north pole of a bar magnet A is moved towards the north pole of a bar magnet B. Means they experience the what is that? They experiencing a repulsive force. At the same time, the north pole of a bar magnet moved towards the south pole. Otherwise, the south pole of a bar magnet moved towards the north pole. They experiencing a attractive force. They experiencing a attractive force because we know that the like charges always repel each other, unlike charges always attract each other. Similarly, the like poles always repel each other, the unlike poles always attract each other. So when the two bar magnets move close to each other, means either they repel each other or they attract each other, isn't it? So there is a force will be developed between the two bar magnets, isn't it? Even that when the light poles are moved towards each other, means they experiencing a repulsive force. When the unlike poles will be moved towards each other, they experiencing a attractive force. So when the two poles are moving each other, means they experiencing a force. The force they experiencing a either the attractive force or either the repulsive force, isn't it? So the pole from the Coulomb states that, what is that? From the Coulomb's inverse law states that Coulomb's inverse law states that, what is that? The Coulomb's inverse law states that the force of attraction or repulsion between the two bar magnets, what is that? The force of attraction or repulsion between the two bar magnets is directly proportional to, what is that? Is directly proportional to product of their pole strength. Is directly proportional to product of their pole strength. Because pole strength of bar magnet A, pole strength of bar magnet B. So the force of attraction between, or force of attraction or repulsion between the two bar magnet is directly proportional to product of their pole strength. Is directly proportional to product of their pole strength, which will be inversely proportional to square of a distance between them. Which will be inversely proportional to square of a distance between them. So what is Coulomb's inverse law states that? The Coulomb's inverse law states that the force of attraction or repulsion between the two bar magnet, the force of attraction or repulsion between the two bar magnet is directly proportional to product of their pole strength, which will be inversely proportional to square of a distance between them. Which will be inversely proportional to square of a distance between them. When the proportional comes to equal, we make a constant K into QMA into QMB divided by R square. Here, the value of K is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi. The value of K is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi. Okay? The value of mu 0 is equal to 4, mu 0 by 4 pi, which will be approximately equal to 10 power minus 7 hundred per meter. Okay? So if you substitute the value of K, then what will get up? F is equal to what is that? F is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi. Mu 0 by 4 pi into Q pole strength of bar magnet A, pole strength of bar magnet B divided by R square. If you write the vector formulas, here you write the unit vector. Unit vector. Okay. So what is the question is state Coulomb's inverse law is what's the point you have to write down? The Coulomb's inverse law states that the force may be attraction or repulsion of the force of attraction or repulsion between the two point charges. What is the force of attraction or repulsion between the two one charge is directly proportional to product of their poles strength, which will be inversely proportional to square of the distance between them. So effector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi qma into pma divided by r square into I cap. Clear? Understand, isn't it? The next one is one of our important final questions, because for this lesson, for that lesson, this will be a first final question. Okay. Magnetic field at a point along the then it's not from one of my marks to the magnetic field at a point along the axial end. Okay, what is the magnetic field at a point along the axial end? Consider a bar magnet. What is that? Consider a bar magnet. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Here x s represents what is that? S represents the south pole of a magnet. N represents the north pole of a magnet. S represents the south pole and N represents the north pole. Each pole having a pole strength qm. Each pole having a pole strength qm separated by distance of half magnetic length 2l. Half magnetic length 2. So what's the point? Consider a bar magnet S1. S represents the south pole of a magnet. N represents the north pole of a magnet. Each pole represents, or each pole having a pole strength qm of a bar magnetic length 2l. Okay. Let's see C be the point at a distance r from the what is that? At a distance r from the midpoint of. Okay, what is the point? Let C be the point. What is that? Let C be the point at a distance r from the midpoint of O along the axial line. Along the axial line. Okay. So what is that point? Let C be the point at a distance r from the midpoint O along the axial line. Okay. Having a pole strength of one unit of north pole strength. Having a one unit of north pole strength. So here what's the pole strength is there? North pole strength is there. Okay, clear? Now, so say what about S is there? Consider a bar magnet SN. S represents the south pole of a magnet. N represents the north pole of a magnet. Let C be the point at a distance r from the midpoint O. Let C be the point at a distance r from the midpoint O having a one unit of north pole strength. So when north they experiencing a attractive force. The north is a here when the south to north is experiencing a repulsive force, isn't it? So right here distance from here to here, the total distance is r. This will be n. So if you subtract means r minus n. Okay, from then from here to there is n. What we get? Here to here r. Here to here l. So the total distance will be r plus l. Clear? Get all of this? So first, so we are going to interact the force of attraction between the north pole of bar magnet and the unit north pole strength. And second one is the force of repulsion between the south pole of bar magnet and the unit pole strength. Then we are adding total magnet. We are going to find the total magnetic field. Okay, clear? So first, the force of attraction between the north pole of a bar magnet and the unit north pole strength. Unit north pole strength. So what we get? F of n vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi. What is that? Mu 0 by 4 pi into here the pole strength is qm, is it? Pole strength is qm. Qm into unit pole strength. So 1 divided by from here to here r minus l the pole square. r minus z the whole square. Write vector form. This will be a positive i cap. This will be a positive i cap. So what we get? F n vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi q m divided by r minus l the whole square into i cap. R minus l the whole square into i cap. This will be equation number 1. Okay, clear? Then second one. From the force of attraction, isn't it? First one is the north pole to north pole, isn't it? So we are experiencing a repulsive force, okay? The force of repulsion between the north pole of a bar magnet and the north pole cylinder. So from here to here, so f of n vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into 2m into unit poles 1 divided by r minus l the whole square into i cap. So f of n vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into 2m by r minus l the whole square into i cap. That will be equation number 1. Then second, force of attraction between, what is the force of attraction between from south pole of a bar magnet to unit pole strength, from the south pole of a bar magnet to unit pole strength. So what we get? F of S vector is equal to F of S vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into qm into unit pole strength. So 1 divided by distance from here to here. Here to here, r plus l. So r plus l. So what we get? R plus l the whole square into minus i cap. Here why it is minus i cap? Means if you take axis of between to 0, means this will be a positive y axis, this will be a negative i axis. So if we take as a minus i cap. Otherwise you are right, if it is attractive force means that should be represented by minus. What is the? If it is attractive force means, what is the? If it is attractive force means that should be represented by minus. Okay. Should represent again with what you get, F plus vector is equal to minus of mu 0 by 4 pi into qm divided by r plus l the whole square into i cap. This will be equation number 2. Okay, so the total force is equal to what you get, F total force is equal to F vector is equal to Fn vector plus F plus vector. Here the total force is represented by what is that? The total force is represented by the magnetic field. What is that? The total force is represented by magnetic field. What is that? The total force will be represented by magnetic field. So what we get? F total is represented by magnetic field B vector. So the B vector will be substituted again is what we get? B vector is equal to F of N vector plus F of S vector. So we are going to substitute the term, okay? So we substitute the term is what we get up? Mu 0 by 4 pi into qm by r minus l the whole square into i cap plus minus. Okay, here what is the? Minus mu 0 by 4 pi qm by r plus s square. Mu 0 by 4 pi into qm divided by r plus l the whole square into i cap. From this term, plus into minus, minus. Then what are the terms in the common? You should be taking out. Okay? So take as a mu 0 by 4 pi qm by r minus l the whole square into i cap. Plus into minus, minus. Isn't it? Plus into minus, minus. So what we get? Minus mu 0 by 4 pi qm by r plus l the whole square into i cap. Okay, now we take a common term of resonance. Mu 0 by 4 pi is a common term, qm common, i cap also common. So you take an answer for the data. Mu 0 into qm by 4 pi 1 by r minus l the whole square minus 1 by r plus l the whole square into i cap. Okay, now already we learned in first lesson, then what are you going to do there? We take LCM, then cross term should be multiplied, then we are exponent by a plus b the whole square formula, a minus b the whole square formula, and a square minus b square formula. Then we are going to substitute, isn't it? So substitute is what we get, mu 0 by 4 pi qm into L. R plus L the whole square minus R minus L the whole square. We take a cross multiplied LCM divided by R minus L the whole square into R plus L the whole square into pi L. Okay. Now we are going to expand the term. What is that? We are going to expand the term. So if we are going to expand the term, so we get the mu 0 by 4 pi qm. This will be exponent by a plus e the whole square formula. This will be exponent by a minus e the whole square formula. So what we get the r square plus l square plus 2rl minus. This will be exponent by a minus e the whole square formula. What is a minus e the whole square formula? A square plus b square minus 3abz, right? R square plus l square minus 2rl divided by here a plus b, a minus b into a plus b. So what we can write the a square minus b square. So what we get the r square minus l square the whole square. Okay. So here a plus b the whole square. Here a plus b the whole square formula. Here a minus b the whole square formula. And this should be multiplied. So r minus b the whole square into r plus b the whole square. So a plus b into a minus b. A square minus b square. So it will be represented by a square minus b square the whole square. Clear? Now, the term should be multiplied, so this is what we get. B vector is equal to mu 0 qm by 2l into. Okay. You should be, the minus term should be multiplied by incidence, right? So what we get? Minus r square, minus l square, minus into minus plus 2r, right? R square plus l square plus 2rl. Then we are going to multiply the term, right? So what we get? Minus r square minus l square. Okay, minus into minus plus 2r plus 2rl divided by r square minus l square the whole square. So here, what are the common term cancel? Plus r square minus r square cancel, plus l square minus l square cancel, isn't it? Cancel. So what do you get? 2r plus 2r, what do you get? As 2r plus 2r, 4r, isn't it? Right? B vector is equal to mu 0 qm by 2l into. So it's 4 pi. So what we get now? 4 rl by r square minus l square the whole square. Okay? Then, the same cost. If r will be greater than elements. That time r will be greater than elements. The l square can be neglected. What is that? R square can be neglected. If the l square will be neglected, means what we get? 2 into 2 r power 4. So right? B vector is equal to mu 0 into qm by 4 pi into. 4 pi into what we get? 4 rl by r power 4. It will be 1, it will be 3, and the 4 can be split by what is that? The 4 can be split by 2 into 2, isn't it? So we write this what we get? B vector is equal to mu 0 qm into, okay, 4l divided by 4 pi into r cube into I curve. Now, we have to split the 4 into 2 into 2, isn't it? Because you know 2 into 2 is equal to 4. If you split the term into what we get, the b vector is equal to mu 0, this 2 mu 0 into qm into 2l I cap by 4 pi into r cube. So guys, what is the equilibrium into here? Guys, what is the equilibrium into here? Qm into 2l I cap is equal to the dipole moment Pm vector. The dipole moment Pm vector. The magnetic dipole moment Pm vector. So if you substitute this expression, means what we get? B vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into mu 0 by 4 pi. 1 2 is the result. So what we get? 2 Pm vector divided by R2. This is the expression for magnetic field at a point. What is that? This will be the expression for the magnetic field at a point along the axial line. This is the expression for the magnetic field at a point along the axial line. Okay? Clear? So what are the points you have to say here? The first point, we take a bar magnet, consider bar magnet, SN, having a pole, S represents the south pole of a bar magnet, N represents the north pole of a bar magnet. Now, Each bar runner having a pole strength, what is that? Each bar runner having a pole strength, 2m. Then, receive the point at a distance r from the point. What is that? Receive the point at a distance r from the midpoint O. Okay, having a unit pole, having a unit north pole strength, having a unit north pole strength, having a unit north pole strength. Now, the first, the force of repulsion between the south pole of the bar runner, assuming this is the south pole. North pole, this will be south to north, this will be point C, distance R. So, here north pole is there, isn't it? One unit of north pole. So, north, north means repulsion, north, south means attraction, isn't it? So, right, the force of repulsion between the north pole of a bar magnet and unit north pole strength is equal to F of N vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi, 2m into 1 divided by, because 1 unit of north pole strength. So 1 divided by r minus l the whole square into I cap. So what we get is f of m vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into qm by r minus l the whole square into I cap. Here r minus l which is represents, what is that? The r minus l which is represents the distance between the north pole of a bar magnet to unit north pole strength. North pole of a bar magnet to unit north pole strength. So what we get up? Then the force of attraction between the south pole of a bar magnet to unit north pole strength, F of S is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into Q unit 1 by R plus L the whole square. So what we get, F of S is equal to minus of mu 0 by 5. Weight is minus. Either attractive force will represent a minus, otherwise you can say is that if you have to split the term, this will be a positive icon, this will be a negative icon, so it will represent a minus icon. So minus of mu 0 by 4 pi into Q by R plus L square into icon. So the total force is equal to F of N vector plus F of S vector. Here the total force will be represented by the magnetic field. So F total is equal to B vector. So the B vector is equal to F of N vector plus F of S vector. Then we are going to substitute both the term. Then plus into minus, minus. Then the common term should be taken out. Since what the common term is there? Mu 0 into qm by 4 pi into I cap. So mu 0 by qm divided by 4 pi into 1 by r minus is the whole square minus 1 by r plus is the whole square into I cap. Then we take LCM, cross multiplication. R plus L the whole square minus R minus L the whole square divided by R minus L the whole square into R plus L the whole square. Then we expand the term by using the formula A plus L the whole square and A minus L the whole square. So A plus L the whole square minus A minus L the whole square. So R square plus L square minus plus 2RL minus R square plus L square minus 2RL divided by R square minus L square the whole square. Then the minus term should be multiplied by this one, we get the minus r square, minus l square, minus into minus plus 2r. So minus plus r square, minus r square, plus l square, minus l square cancel. 2r plus 2r, 4r. Okay, then we can, if a point C is far away from the bar magnet base, what is that? If a point C is far away from the bar magnet, so the distance r will be greater than l, so the l square can be neglected. L square can be neglected. So if the time L square can be neglected means what we get the B vector is equal to mu 0 qm by 4 pi into 4 r divided by r power 4. So r will be cancelled, it will be cube. Then we split the 4 into what is that? We split the 4 term 4 into 2 into 2. So mu 0 by qm by 4 l divided by 4 pi into r cube. That 4 will be split up. So 1 2 is here, 2 is 2 into mu 0 qm into 2 l I cap divided by 4 pi into r cube. So we know that 2m into 2l is a dipole moment, because we know that what is my magnetic dipole moment? The magnetic dipole moment is defined as product of its force strength at a magnetic length, isn't it? So 2m into 2l, I cap is 3m vector, so we substitute what we get, b vector is equal to mu 0 by 4 pi into 2 pm vector by r cube. Okay, this is the expression for the magnetic field at a point along the axial line, okay? Clear? So today's session is what are the questions we learn? We learn 1 3 mark questions and 1 5 mark questions. Both are very very important questions. One is the state Coulomb's inverse square law. What is state Coulomb's inverse square law? The force of attraction and repulsion between the two poles strength is going to be directly proportional to product of the poles strength, and which will be inversely proportional to square of the distance between them. The next one is one of our important 5 mark questions. For orthogonalness, this will be a first priority 5 mark question. What's the question? The magnetic field at a point along the axial line. Okay. So I hope you should be learned very clear. This will be one of our important 5 mark questions, okay? And you should learn all the other 2 mark questions in the previous class we taken, okay? Clear? And you should be finished the first and second lesson very clear. And for next week we have home test, isn't it? For the home test, you should be learned very clear. We are going to learn, you guys are going to learn the first lesson. First lesson, what are the questions we taken or whatever part we finished, that part you should be learned very clear. I think I almost finished all the portions, isn't it? So thank you guys, you should be learned very clear, okay? Thank you.